यूनिफिकेशन ऑफ इटली. ऑल राइट, सो लेट मी गिव यू अ ब्रीफ स्टोरी लाइन एंड देन वी विल स्टार्ट राइटिंग अबाउट इट. व्हेन आई टॉक अबाउट इटली बिफोर इट्स यूनिफिकेशन, राइट, सो इटली इज समथिंग लाइक दिस, राइट, दिस इज इटली. नाउ दिस इटली एज अ लैंड मास, हाउ इट वॉज डिवाइडेड, दिस इज द पार्ट ऑफ पिडमोंट सार्दिनिया. This side is Piedmont Sardinia, where that Savoy dynasty was ruling, right? This is north of Italy, where Austria had its control. On north of Italy, you remember I told you Austria had its control. This is island of Sicily. This is Sicily. So this is south of Italy. Here France had its control. I hope you remember this as well. North of Italy, it was Austria, and south of Italy, it was France. Now, this is central Italy. In central Italy, it was control of Pope, right? So, Italy was divided into many parts. Then, you know what happened? 1789, that French Revolution started. And when the French Revolution started, Napoleon came into picture. When Napoleon came into picture, he automatically took control of south of Italy. He defeated the Savoys. He took control over north of Italy as well. And he even asked Pope to leave the central Italy. So entire Italy came under control of Napoleon. Now, when for the first time, entire Italy has come under control of Napoleon. Now, let's compare it today with something. Before the British came to India, in India, there were many rulers ruling in different parts, right? When they all were different kings. So everyone had different administration. Everyone had different rules and everyone had different identities. Then British one by one started defeating all these rulers of India and they captured entire India. When British captured entire India, now Indian nationalism arose and Indian came together to ask British to leave India, right? When British became masters of entire India, only then we realized that we all are one and then we fought a common battle against British. Similarly, when Napoleon came and brought entire Italy under his control, now, people of Italy, be it North Italy, Central Italy, or South Italy, they all realized that we are one. Now, they became more strong in their idea of nationalism. So, can we say that Napoleon created the scope for Italian unification? Now that Napoleon has brought that sense of nationalism in entire Italy, then they all together fought against Napoleon, right? Now that Napoleon is defeated in 1813 to 15's time, Napoleon is defeated. So people of Italy wanted that now they should get their own rulers. They should enjoy their own independence. But then came Congress of Vienna in 1815. And this Congress of Vienna, it tried to do. Now that Congress of Vienna was called. In Congress of Vienna, it was Austria who was to decide everything. And who was the king of Austria at that time? It was Prince Metternich who was to take all the decisions. Now, what Metternich will do, he said, restore the old system. That means Austria got back north of Italy. Pope came back to central Italy. France got back the south of Italy. Where is the nationalism of Italian people? You have tried to crush the idea of nationalism. So if we say that Napoleon brought nationalism to Italy, Congress of Vienna tried to crush it. If they did it, they were not successful. If they tried it, they were not successful, but they did try to crush nationalism. But at the same time, they made one major contribution in bringing the idea of strong Italian state. How? If you remember, Congress of Vienna gave extra territory to Piedmont Sardinia. When Piedmont Sardinia got additional territory, now they have become stronger. And this Piedmont Sardinia will then lead Italian unification. Simple. Now, another very important thing, the last thing, then 1830 and 1848 revolutions happened. In both these revolutions, people of Italy again tried to bring a strong Italian state, but somehow they failed. They tried, but they failed. After the failure of 1848 revolution, now the king of Piedmont Sardinia changes, right? Old man leaves and his son becomes the king. I will give you the names. Now, when this new king to Piedmont Sardinia came, he appointed a new prime minister by the name of Cavour, C-A-V-O-U-R. Cavour became the new prime minister of Piedmont Sardinia. Now, to this man goes the credit for bringing Italian unification. How and what he did? You have to understand this logic, because this makes a very important question for us. Now, what he did is, Cavour understand that Piedmont Sardinia is not very, very strong. Piedmont Sardinia independently cannot fight against Austria, and they cannot fight against France. And then to challenge the authority of Pope is going to be a big challenge. So what should we do so that we can protect the integration, or we can ensure the unification of Italy and defeat Austria without any threat from France or any challenge from the Papal Kingdom? So the solution that Cavour found. Now, what was happening in Europe? Listen to this idea very carefully, because this idea will keep on repeating itself now n number of times. This is my so-called flat world map. Here I have North America. Here I have South America, right? South of America. This is Central America. So this is your Americas. Then there is an ocean here and ocean here, right? Then here we have that Europe. With Europe on this side, we have Russia, right? Here we have Central Asia. Here we have that Middle East area. Here we have Africa. And here we have that India, Australia, right? Now look at this world map and try to understand something. Now look at this. America, this is USA, this is Canada. There were the 13 colonies. This is Mexico. And from here, the Central America starts. This is all Central America, Mexico region, and this all region. And this is South America, right? Now America has ocean on both sides. They can do any side trade from anywhere, right? So is the case with Canada and everything, then with Greenland. Now look at the map of Russia here. Russia is landlocked on all sides, right? It is landlocked. There are different countries here. Russia is all landlocked. There is no scope for Russia to enter into ocean from this side. Here they have Mongolia, China, Kazakhstan. Then here is Ukraine, Belarus, Estonia, Latvia, Finland, all these countries. And if I look at this side of the ocean, it is always and always frozen. They cannot travel and do any trade. Now, when I talk about trade all over the world, right? Look at this. If I have to buy things from China or from Japan or from Taiwan, Philippines, Malaysia, Indonesia, anywhere, this is the main sea route, right? This is a very prominent sea route. If I have to get oil from Middle East, Iran, Iraq, Saudi, Yemen, Oman, right? This is Middle East. If I buy oil from this side, I need to send it to this side, China, Korea, and anywhere. So obviously it will go through this side, right? So the world trade goes through Indian Ocean. It is a very important link. The Indian Ocean is a very important link for world trade. For Russia, it is never a possibility to enter into this ocean. One, two. Now, when I talk about the land route is China going through India to Pakistan, to Afghanistan, to Iran, to Turkey. And from Turkey, they enter into Eastern Europe, Bulgaria, Romania, Czechoslovakia, Germany. It is all connected, right? So there had been a land route in old times that is called the Old Silk Route. So neither Russia has access to this land route, nor can they have access to this oceanic route. So Russia always was finding it very difficult that how can they enter into the global trade. Before World War I, and if we go back into the times when Britain and France were exploring the geographical areas and they were trying to colonize, if we talk about 1600, 1700, 1800 time. So the entire fight between Britain and France, why Britain and France, UK and France, they were enemies. They both wanted to control this land route as well as the oceanic route, right? They both wanted to control it. That is why Britain wanted to keep India, Pakistan with them. That is why Britain was trying to enter into Afghanistan. British army was fighting wars in Iran, Persia, and in Indian Ocean. Both were trying to plant their navies. But then Britain and France realized that we will keep fighting for this. And unfortunately, if Russia somehow enter into the Mediterranean Sea coming from Ukraine, if they come into Mediterranean Sea. From Mediterranean Sea, they can enter into Africa, or they can come through Turkey and then attack India, come into Indian Ocean and control the trade. Neither Britain nor France ever wanted Russia to come into this trade, because of which Russia and Britain, despite being enemies for quite some time, now they have become friends. I'm talking about 1800s. They became friends for what? They wanted to hold back Russia and never let Russia enter into the ocean or the global trade. Now, because they became friends, they decided that we will not let Russia move further into this region. This is Crimean region, right? Crimean region. So Britain and France decided that they will not come from this side. For which purpose in European history, Crimean War was fought? This Crimean War was fought in 1853 to 56 time, right? This is the time when Britain and France as friends are fighting against Russia to stop Russia from entering into the maritime trade route. This is old story. Now, this land route, there is a story called, isko basically bolte hain, Great Game. Great Game is between Britain and Russia, so that this land route must not fall to Russia, right? Britain and Russia were playing Great Game, that this route must not be taken by Russia. Britain wanted to control it. So Britain and France became friends to fight against Russia, so that Russia must not enter into this area, Crimean, then coming to Ukraine and coming down and entering into the Mediterranean. All right, this is one. Now, what is more important? When all this is happening, Italy is nowhere in the picture. Italy is not a country. Here we have Piedmont Sardinia. Now, the prime minister of Piedmont Sardinia was Cavour. What Cavour did? Without being invited by France or Britain to help them in the Crimean War, Cavour sent his army to Crimean War to support Britain and France. Now, neither Britain nor France have asked them, but Cavour sent the army of Piedmont Sardinia. With this, he earned the praise of France and Britain. Right? Now that he has earned the praise of France and Britain, when the war ended, Russia was defeated. Obviously, after every war, a meeting is called, like Congress of Vienna. This time again, a meeting was called. For the first time, when a meeting was called, where strong countries like Russia, Britain, and France, and Austria, and everyone is sitting. Today, you invited Piedmont Sardinia too, a small country like Piedmont Sardinia. When Piedmont Sardinia went to this meeting, Cavour started making hue and cry that Austria is not letting Italians have their freedom. Today, Britain and France, because they have just been held by Cavour, Britain said, okay, in that case, I am neutral from today. I will not interfere. Whatever you want to do with Austria, you are free. So Britain became neutral. France said, okay, I can help you, but on the condition that if Austria attacks you, only then I will come and help you. Now, Cavour has earned a friend in France and a neutral friend in Britain. After this, whenever he will fight against Austria, Britain will not interfere, Russia will help. So a writer said, Italy was born out of Crimean mud. Do you understand that? There was a Crimean War between Russia on one side and Britain or France on other side. Italy had no role, but Cavour intentionally went there, involved himself in an unnecessary war. But out of the war, he got one friend who will support him, one friend who will turn neutral, and thus Italy will be born. So Italy was born out of Crimean mud. Now, I have to tell you another thing. Earlier in 1700 and 1800, Britain and France were enemies for this trade route and everything. Then they found that Russia is making a lot of efforts. So Britain and France became friends against Russia, right? Now, Russia tried many a times. This is Britain. This is France. Here we have Britain and here we have France, right? They are looking towards this side, to the east side of Europe. When they look to the east side of Europe, they think, shall we allow Russia to enter here in this side? And the answer is no. For Britain and France, this is Eastern question. like, shall we let this area be controlled by Russia or not? Because if Russia will try to control it, then there will be a lot of problem. All right. This is one. Another thing. Now let's look at another thing. When I look at another thing, it says that when it was 17 and 1800s, it was Britain on one side fighting Russia on the other side. Russia was trying to enter into this area. They never let it happen. When it was 1900s, Britain and Russia were still fighting the great game. And then World War II happened and Britain became weak. Now, when Britain became weak, Russia already had become USSR. It was a great power now. So Britain said that we are now not able to contain them. They may enter into Eastern Europe. So we want now USA to do this. So USA and USSR, from 1945 onwards, after World War II, they fought Cold War, right? What was this Cold War? That Russia must not continue moving further. But you know what Russia did? Russia took over Ukraine. Russia took control in Poland, in Czechoslovakia, Romania, Bulgaria. Entire Eastern Europe became supporter of Russia. So the Cold War was fought to stop Russia move further into Germany, France, Spain, and Portugal. So America invested a lot of money, army, men, material to stop Russia move further from this side. So through and through the Cold War, American policy was to stop Russia moving further. And ultimately, American policies were successful. And this Russia, which was USSR, it broke down. Once it broke down, Kazakhstan became an independent country. Georgia became independent. Ukraine, all these countries became independent. Now Russia is again small, right? Russia cannot enter into this. All this happened in 1990-91. America thought, we have won. Now nobody will trouble us. In the meanwhile, in 2000s, now China came up. And China started disputing all these sea routes. They said, we will control these sea routes. In 2015-16, China started talking about Belt Road Initiative. We will connect to Europe ourselves, BRI of China. Now America has same concerns against China. So what they were fighting against Russia, now the Americans are fighting against China. Now that's the story of BRI and America, China having problems. So let's start with unification of Italy. I've given you the background. So look at this. Italy, one of the most prestigious European countries in ancient age. This is the time when we are talking about, when we talk about Roman Empire, right? Roman Empire ruled over the world. Rome is Italy. So Italy, one of the most prestigious European countries in ancient age when it was Roman Empire. But then it underwent political fragmentation. It broke down during the medieval period. Then we know that in north of Italy, the Austrians came, south of Italy, France came, central Italy, Papal Kingdom was established. Now it was just a geographical expression. We call it Italy, but it is not one country divided into many countries. Then condition of Italy before Napoleon's campaign, before Napoleon came, what was the position in Italy? In 1796, Italy totally fragmented. North Italy controlled by Austria. In Piedmont Sardinia, PS, it was ruled by King of Savoy dynasty and Charles Albert was the king, and it was the only native rule in Italy. Any Italian ruling in Italy, it was only and only Charles Albert of Savoy dynasty. Central Italy ruled by Pope's representatives, and the state of Naples, Sicily, located in south, ruled by a branch of French Bourbon dynasty. So as I explained, in North Austria center, it is Papal Kingdom, Pope's authority. South, it is France. Only Piedmont Sardinia is ruled by a native ruler. Then comes Napoleon to Italy. Napoleon and Italy. When Napoleon conquered Italy in 1796-97, after defeating Austrian forces. Now what happens? Napoleon initiated numbers of reform in accordance with the ideals of French Revolution. That is liberty, equality, and fraternity. So he said, Napoleon said, see, I am coming from revolutionary France, where we have now the ideas of liberty, equality, fraternity, very popular. So I would like to give the same ideas to the people of Italy as well. So what he ended up doing, he promoted liberty, equality, and fraternity and destroyed the feudal institutions and privileges. That means he started making the process of modern Italy possible. Napoleon himself started doing this. The regressive institutions like guilds were wiped out and free trade was adopted. With this free trade, economic development of Italy will also start. So Napoleon is creating the scope to make modern, economically strong Italy. And he is doing it for what reason? He thought that I will continue ruling over the Italian region. Then Napoleon reminded Italians of their glorious past, that in the old times we were great Romans. Now we are being ruled over by outsiders. Then next, LWE reforms. This is LEF basically, not LWE. LEF, Liberty, Equality, Fraternity reforms awakened people of Italy. And after 1808, Napoleon's rule became a little more despotic. Now people were expecting that they will get liberty and equality, but Napoleon became very, very despotic. He started ruling in undemocratic manner, started forcing decisions on people of Italy. So a strong sense of nationalism emerged in Italy because of the despotic policy of Napoleon. After 1808, now people of Italy started thinking about getting democratic rights, and the Italian nationalism gained strength and culminated in political unification later. So this is one background, that what was the condition of Italy before the coming of Napoleon and how Napoleon brought changes in Italy. Now what is next? Vienna Congress and Italy. Now when that Vienna Congress met, Vienna Order of 1815 restored old political scenario, the old scene, and Italy again fragmented into number of political entities. Once again, what happened? Lombardy and Venetia merged with Austria. We wrote this yesterday, right? Rule of Austrian princes restored in Parma, Modena, Tuscany. I told you, write only Parma and nothing else. Yesterday I told you Parma, Modena, Tuscany, but you write only Parma in three states like Parma, right? Central Italy placed under Pope once again. Rome ruled by Pope directly. Central states as Umbria and Marches ruled by Pope's representatives. That means Pope is sitting only in Rome. In the surrounding areas, there are his representatives. Then Bourbon dynasty of France ruled restored in Naples, Sicily, that is South Italy, and House of Savoy re-established in Piedmont, Sardinia. Exactly what was the scene before the coming of Napoleon? The same was once again restored by the Congress of Vienna, as I just explained today and we wrote yesterday. Genoa was given to Piedmont, Sardinia to help it counter French aggression in southeastern direction. They intentionally made Piedmont, Sardinia strong so that in future, if ever France tries to attack any other country, Piedmont, Sardinia can stop it. So Piedmont, Sardinia strengthened could lead unification in future because they were given more territory. They became more powerful. Now in future, they can bring Italian unification. Now what happens? Early efforts towards unification of Italy. Early efforts. Now in the early efforts, there is a role of an organization called Carbonari. What is Carbonari? It was established in 1810 and was an association of coal miners. In Italy, the people who were involved in coal mining, they made an organization like Carbonari. It is a nationalist organization. Members assembled to discuss problems. Declared objectives were liberation of Italy from foreign rule. We don't want Austrians and French to rule in Italy. For this, they made Carbonari and grant of legal freedom to all Italians. So this is like a freedom organization or a movement. Like in India, we can say we made organizations like Congress and others. They made Carbonari. It achieved no significant gain because it had weak leadership and there was no harmonious plan. They made efforts, but they failed. As we can say, before Congress in India, we went for 1857 revolt. Because there was no plan, there was no strong leader. So revolt of 1857 failed, but it became an inspiration for future. So what happened? Now they made a plan, but the plan was not very strong. So it failed. So role of Carbonari is more or less like the revolt of 1857, which even if it failed, it inspired the next movement in India. Similarly, Carbonari inspired the next movement in Italy. Then what happens next is, revolution of 1830 and Italy. When this revolution of 1830 in Italy started, right, what happened in Italy then? Success of July Revolution in France, 1830, you remember it is July Revolution. The success of July Revolution in France now emboldened the Italians to rise against foreign rule and to fight for their liberty. So people of Italy, inspired by the 1830 revolution of France, they again revolted. Popular revolutions broke out in Parma, Modena, Tuscany, Naples, Sicily. Means this is north under Austria, this is south under France. So they were now fighting against Austrians in north and French in south, so that it can be free, independent Italy. Metternich maintained effective control over Italy and Germany, because Metternich in 1830 was strong. He sent his army and crushed the revolt in Italy. Then sent Austrian forces to suppress revolution in Italy. Who? Metternich. He sent his forces, and the Italian revolt of 1830, it failed. But even if it failed, it still kept the idea of nationalism grow further, right? Because of this 1830 efforts of the Italians that we want to become independent of French and the Austrians, nationalism became more stronger. Now, Carbonari was the first attempt. 1830 is the second attempt. Even though they are not able to become independent, but the idea of nationalism is growing stronger. Then Mazzini and unification of Italy. Mazzini is one character in Italian history who is called the soul of unification. Why he is called soul of unification? Because he is among those early leaders who tried to inspire the Italian youth to fight for their independence. He is a very important writer, political writer, as well as an early nationalist. Now, what he did? Mazzini, who was a revolutionary thinker and a radical nationalist, was inspired by aims of transforming Italy into a united entity, that it should be one strong Italy. He always wanted to do this in order to get Italy a place of honor and prestige in community of nations, so that whenever global community sit and discuss things, they should take Italy into consideration. If Italy is divided into so many countries, nobody will bother about Italy, right? So this was aim of Mazzini. He established nationalist organization called Young Italy in 1831 to arouse the Italians that you have to fight for your independence. Remember one thing for Italy. This Young Italy of Mazzini became so strong an inspiration for Indian nationalists that the organizations like Abhinav Bharat was a direct inspiration from Young Italy. This is an Indian organization which fought during freedom struggle. So Abhinav Bharat was an inspiration from Young Italy. Mazzini himself was so strong that his autobiography was translated into so many Indian languages, and the Indian revolutionaries used to read it. Lala Lajpat Rai translated his autobiography into Punjabi language and even into Urdu. And it was translated and distributed among people of Punjab, so that even they can rise and fight against the British on the lines in which Italians did. So this became a very, very strong inspiration for world over freedom struggles, what Mazzini was doing in Italy, right? Now, this man who established Young Italy, what he started doing by establishing Young Italy, highlighted common elements of diverse culture in Italy. That irrespective of the fact that we have little bit of differences, at the end, we all are Italians. We have something common, and encourage Italians to rise against foreign rulers, be it Austrians or the French. Propagated spirit of sacrifice for cause of national pride, that you should be ready to live your life, to give your life, so that the nation must be given its place of dignity and honor. His writings and speeches brought intellectual revolution in Italy. And on the basis of this intellectual revolution, the unification will now start in a proper manner. So if they ask you to write a short note, role of Mazzini in Italian unification, this is your answer. Now that his writings brought intellectual revolution, Italians started thinking on nationalist lines. People are inspired. When they are inspired, Italian nationalism arose by Mazzini played important role in unification process later. he did his work in 1830s. Unification came in 1860s. Then revolution of 1840 and unification of Italy. When Metternich himself failed and he fell in March 1848, we did yesterday. With the fall of Metternich, now Italians are further encouraged to make more efforts for their liberation. They want to get freedom. When Metternich fell, Mazzini and other Italian nationalists persuaded King Charles Albert of Piedmont, Sardinia to lead fights against Austria. He is the only Italian in the entire region. So all the nationalists, including Mazzini, they ask King Charles Albert, let's fight together and drive the Austrians at least from out of north of Italy, so that at least North Italy becomes one country. Pope was Pius IX and Ferdinand II of Naples, Sicily were pressurized to join the fight. So what exactly is happening? In south of Italy, there is Austrian rule. And in this Austrian rule, Ferdinand II is the king in south of Italy. France ka raja, south of Italy mein. Bourbon, Ferdinand II ruling in south of Italy, right? He is the French king who is ruling south of Italy, Ferdinand II. In central Italy, there is Pope Pius IX. So the North Italians, Piedmont, Sardinia, tried to convince Pope as well as the French ruler in south, let's fight together as one unit Italy and at least let's drive the Austrian out. So there was an effort by Piedmont Sardinia to unite central and south Italy to fight against Austria. So Pope and Ferdinand were pressurized to join the fight. War against Austria commenced. Now war started with great enthusiasm, but Pope and Ferdinand withdrew their forces during the ongoing battle. Now why they went out? When they saw that Piedmont Sardinia is becoming a hero, and entire North Italy is joining hands with them to fight Austria. Now Pope and South Italy, they realize that if Piedmont Sardinia becomes a hero, they win the war, then people in South and Central Italy will also look to them as their leader. Then they can lead a war against us as well. So they thought, let us not let them become the real heroes. So they left the war in between. They left the war in between so that Piedmont Sardinia must not win and they must not become heroes in the eyes of people. Now that the Pope and Ferdinand, they left in between, King Charles Albert is left alone. Now, how can alone he can fight and win the war? So Piedmont Sardinia forces faced crushing defeats in Battle of Custoza and Novara in 1848-49. The names of the battles are not important. You can even tell your examiner that because all left and they were left alone, so they were defeated. That will be sufficient. So the names of these battles are not important. You can ignore them and just tell that King Albert was left alone and therefore he was defeated. And then as per the terms of peace, now that the war ended, people said Charles Albert, who was the king of Piedmont Sardinia, he has to leave the throne now. He has to resign, right? So Charles Albert abdicated, he resigned, and his son Victor Emmanuel II became the new king of what? Of Piedmont Sardinia. Now a young boy has become a king. Obviously, he is more ambitious, more courageous, and more talented. Now, Italian nationalists now learned an important lesson. Lesson is they realized that political unification of Italy could take place only under Piedmont Sardinia. Neither Pope nor French rulers in South will help us. So we have to only and only now look towards the Piedmont Sardinian state for our unification. Pope and King of Naples, Sicily are not reliable. We will never again ask them to support for Italian unification. Austria could be pushed out only through war. That means we have to fight a strong war to put Austria out of Italian affairs. And lessons made Italians smarter and unification process in future planned more effectively. This is how now the things will move further. So 1848 revolution was a great, great inspiration for Italians for the next steps to be taken. Now the real beginning of the process of unification starts because a new king has come. Now what happens next? Appointment of Count Cavour, as I told you, as Prime Minister of Piedmont. So the new king, Victor, Cavour was appointed Prime Minister of Piedmont Sardinia by not Charles Albert, it is Victor Emmanuel. And you know the name in the previous sheet, right? Cavour was appointed the Prime Minister by King Victor Emmanuel in 1852. And this man, Cavour, he's a man of strong nationalist ideas. And he believed that unification is possible under leadership of Piedmont Sardinia. Now he will start making efforts for unification of Italy. But there are many obstacles in the way of Italian unification when Cavour is to start. Now, what are the obstacles? First obstacle is Vienna Order of 1850, and it is the biggest obstacle. Why? Because when the Vienna Order was prepared, when Metternich system was created, it intentionally kept Italy divided and fragmented, and any effort to alter it will be opposed by big powers of Europe. Why? Because this Vienna Order is guaranteed by Austria, France, Britain, and then Prussia. All big players have guaranteed it. If Italy will try to disturb this Vienna Order, it has to fight against all the big players, not just Austria, even France, Britain, and Prussia. So Austria is not the only enemy. Every European player of any significance is a guarantor to this Vienna Order. If you disturb it, you invite their aggression. Then another obstacle is foreign rule in Italy. It is not just one player. You have to fight Austria. You have to fight France as well. There is so much. Like in India, it was only British. You fought against British, you became independent. Here you have to fight against Austria as well as France. Then North Italy under Austrian domination, South under the branch of French Bourbon dynasty. You have two enemies in two corners. You have to decide a very straightforward policy. Moreover, presence of Pope and Papal kingdoms in central Italy, Pope respected by the Catholics. If you do any harm to Pope, the entire Catholic world, Europe, where Catholic religion is believed, they will, any move to effect his position attracted sharp international reaction. All Catholic nations will turn against Italy immediately. You just cannot think of a war without being very strong. Geographical division of Italy into three main regions. North Italy is different, Central is different, South is different. You have to make sure that all of them should come on a common platform. Only then you can think of a collective effort for unification. Italy was economically very backward because no trace of industrial revolution in Italy. Italy is very backward. In middle of 19th century and sharp economic differences between North and South Italy, North is comparatively little richer. South is very poor, and till date it is. As we talked about America, North America was rich, South America was poor. Similar was the condition in Italy. Then existence of hundreds of local cultures, very strong centrifugal force, dividing force. You cannot think, like in India, when I speak Hindi, the students from South India, they start crying, don't speak Hindi, we do not understand. If I speak only and only English, many students from North and Central India, they start asking me and crying, don't speak only English, we cannot understand. Similarly, it was the problem that neither they speak the common language nor they have the common religion, and many other things are different. Ideological differences among Italian leaders, like Cavour, the main leader, he is a liberal monarchical state perspective. He said, let's have a king, it's okay, but there should be some liberal ideas as well. So the main leaders believe in liberal monarchical state, whereas the other leaders like Mazzini and Garibaldi, he's an important leader, I will come to him later, they favored republic, there should be no king. Now, when the main leaders are not agreeing on a common thing, where Cavour says that let the king be there, we will not give him many powers, Mazzini and Garibaldi say, no, we don't want a king, we need a republic where head should be elected. And there is Ghiberti, another very important leader, who wanted Italian federation under Pope. He said, let Pope be the king and one Italy be there. So different leaders were talking about different ideas, because of which it was very difficult to bring a common placed notion that how Italy is to be unified. Weakness of Piedmont Sardinia. Piedmont Sardinia itself is not very strong. So unification depends on external assistance. You need somebody from outside to come and help you. That is why he will go into Crimean War. And the nobles and feudal lords were against unification. If Italy becomes one, their rights and privileges will come to an end because it will be liberal democratic Italy. So these were the main problems or obstacles in Italian unification. Now, despite all these challenges, how did Cavour respond it and brought a two-pronged strategy to make Italy unified? Now, see what he will do, how Cavour will make Italian unification possible. Number one, he initiated number of liberal reforms in Piedmont, Sardinia, where he is the prime minister. If I introduce changes in my state, positive changes, modern changes, then what will happen? I will become a model state that will attract the attention of others. If I become a model state, among all the Italian region, Piedmont, Sardinia become a role model, be it the northern states or the central or the states of southern Italy. They all now look towards Piedmont, Sardinia as a role model. So obviously they are ready to accept Piedmont, Sardinia as their leader. So firstly, he started with liberal reforms and made Piedmont, Sardinia a model state. Now, what were these liberal reforms? Liberty of press was expanded. Freedom of press is given. Everybody is so happy. Like, look at Piedmont, Sardinia. If they can give so much of freedom to press, why can't our kings give it to us? Liberal rights granted to all citizens. Banks were established for modern economic development. Cooperative societies for economic development were created. Church privileges abolished and taxes imposed on the property of church, with which they got more money. With this money, powerful army was raised. Now Piedmont, Sardinia is militarily strong, economically strong, and there are liberal reforms. Everybody is looking towards this Piedmont, Sardinia with such a pride that if they can be someone like this, why can't all of us be like them? And why can't their leader be our leaders? And defense of Piedmont, Sardinia strengthened by repairing old forts and constructing new forts so that in case of war, they can handle the situation well. Now that he has internally changed everything, now comes the turn of external thing. So Cavour used his diplomacy to create favorable external environment. And this opportunity came in the shape of Battle of Crimea, which I just explained. Now let us have a look at this. Battle of Crimea and Italian unification. Britain and France on one side and Russia on other, from October 1853 to March 1856, fought the Crimean War, which was fought over Eastern question. I hope I have already explained all these points. Crimean War, Britain, France, one side, Russia, other, Eastern question. Then what happened? Russia was trying to expand influence onto Near East across Black Sea at the cost of Ottoman Empire. Now, I have to again show you the world map to make you understand, but I will show you now once we are done with Italian unification. Three slides are left. This Ottoman Empire was called Sick Man of Europe and was ruled by Caliph. We'll come back and discuss this. I haven't discussed this point in detail, but I will explain, don't worry. So Russia was trying to enter into Near East or across Black Sea at the cost of Ottoman Empire. Britain and France were interested in keeping Russia away from Near East to protect international routes passing through the Mediterranean Sea. This I explained, that Britain and France never wanted Russia to come near to the Mediterranean Sea. Because of this, the BC most purposeless battle, the Battle of Crimea, BC's Battle of Crimea, is the most purposeless battle fought in European history, because there is no direct interest for Piedmont, Sardinia. Mud of Crimea, that means unnecessary involvement, right? Mud of Crimea created important environment for success of Italian unification. How? To gain support and sympathy, Cavour sent 18,000 Piedmontese soldiers in 1854 to help Britain and France. Gesture greatly appreciated by Britain and France. Thanks, bro, you sent your soldiers. They gave us some respite. We could fight easily and win the war. Now a peace conference was held in Paris when this Crimean War ended. A peace conference was held in Paris, where even Cavour was invited. And here, when Cavour went, he highlighted the sufferings of Italians against the Austrians, that Austrians are not giving us independence. When in this meeting, he highlighted the problems. Now a Polembers Pact was signed. This is very important. P-L-O-M-B-I-E-R apostrophe S and pact. Polembers Pact. It was signed in 1858 by Cavour and the French Emperor Napoleon III. Napoleon III is the King of France who signed Polyamber's Pact with Cavour, and France agreed to support Piedmont Sardinia against Austria with a force of 2 lakh soldiers, provided Austria initiates war. Agar Austria start kare war, if Austria starts the war, only then France will send 2 lakh soldiers. Now look at this. Piedmont Sardinia has 90,000 soldiers total, and France will send 2 lakh soldiers. Their strength will be increased like anything. So now France has promised that they will send 2 lakh soldiers to help Piedmont Sardinia, but if Austria starts the war. Now, to provoke Austria to start the war, what is now the need? Cavour need to provoke Austria to start war. If he can provoke them, then he will get French army. Lombardy was successfully liberated. What Cavour did, he provoked people of Lombardy that you are Italian, come to my side. Lombardy successfully liberated, but when the turn of Venetia came, Napoleon III withdrew his troops. Why he withdrew now? Why France walked out of this alliance? The reason is war stopped. Cavour wanted to continue, but King Victor Emmanuel makes his decision as he was aware of Austrian might. That means Italy could not yet defeat Austria completely, Piedmont Sardinia, but they had to stop the war because France withdrew their troops. I know this point makes a little confusion, so I am explaining it once again. At the Polyamber's Pact, when this pact was signed, Austria is the enemy. Now, Piedmont Sardinia are talking to France, and France said, I will send 2 lakh soldiers if Austria attacks, right? So Piedmont Sardinia are now sure that France will send us 2 lakh soldiers if Austria starts the war. So what Piedmont Sardinia, the Prime Minister Cavour did, he provoked the people in Lombardy to revolt. When the people of Lombardy revolted, Austria, obviously, it has got Lombardy and it has got the two states, Lombardy and Venetia, from Congress of Vienna. Now, when people of Lombardy will revolt against Austria, Austria will obviously send army. Now that Austria sent army, who started war? Austria. Because Austria started war, French sent their 2 lakh soldiers. With the help of French soldiers, now Piedmont Sardinia defeated Austria in Lombardy and they got Lombardy. Lombardy is now liberated from the control of Austria. But when it was the turn of Venetia, the next state, now Napoleon III withdrew his troops. Now, why he withdrew his troops? It is written here. But meanwhile, because now France is not supporting Piedmont Sardinia, even though Cavour wanted to continue and fight the war for Venetia, King did not agree. Victor Emmanuel said, no, without France, we cannot defeat Austria. So let's stop. Now that the king did not agree to what Prime Minister Cavour is saying, Cavour felt disillusioned and resigned from the post of Prime Minister. So Italy is not yet unified, but Cavour left in between and resigned from the post of this. After which in July 1859, Peace of Villafranche was signed and Lombardy merged with Piedmont Sardinia. They have got one territory. Venetia still remain with Austria. Now, why France withdrew from the battle? France withdrew from battle against Austria for 4 reasons. Number one, large number of French soldiers died. Now, the people of France were asking their king, Napoleon III, what kind of a fool you are? To help Italy become strong, you are letting your soldiers die? What sensible decision this is? Please bring back your army. We don't want our men to die for Italian unification. Two, French nationalist opposing support to Piedmont because of powerful state of Italy emerging on French borders. Now, people of France are asking, are you a bloody fool, Mr. Napoleon III? You are helping Piedmont become such a powerful state. In future, they can become our enemies. Italy can become enemy to France. Why are you helping such a strong state emerge on the borders of France? Then, French people are Catholic. So they fear that united North Italy can do harm to Pope's prestige. They can attack Central Italy. We are Catholics. We respect the Pope. How can we help somebody who can in future threaten Pope? Then Prussia started mobilizing her troops to support Austria. if Prussia sends army, then it will turn into a European war. Prussia, Austria, Italy, France, everybody will get involved. It will be big destruction in Europe once again. Why you want to do this? So King of France decided, because of these four factors, all right, I am bringing my soldiers back. So the war ended. Phase of unification, integration of Parma, Modena, Tuscany, north of Italy, Romagna and Bologna. These are North Italian states. If you don't remember these names, that's all right. It's okay. You can only say unification of North Italy. Even that will serve the purpose. If you say unification of North Italy and bringing territories like Parma inside, even that will be okay. There is no need for us to remember every name in GS. Now, what will happen next? Piedmontese war against Austria arose nationalist aspirations in Italy. Because now Piedmont army started fighting against Austria, entire north of Italy is now full with the spirit of nationalism. They want independence. So massive revolutions broke out in Parma, Modena, Tuscany, and the rulers fled. Jo rule kar rahe the, Austrians, they fled. Now that there are so much of the revolts in North Italy, the king is not able to understand what is happening. So he called back Cavour. Mr. Cavour, please come. I am not able to handle. I am not accepting your resignation. You will continue to be my prime minister. Cavour immediately returned back and said, they have stopped me from making Italy through diplomacy from North. I was trying to make Italy from North Italy. I will make it through revolt from South. Then I will fight against France now. Moreover, France left in between. Now we are justified fighting the French as well. So instead of fighting in North, let's start the process from South. And very smart move it will be. Austria and Prussia wanted to restore banished rulers of Piedmont, Sardinia, but British Prime Minister Palmerston declared Italy to be left alone to decide her fate. Mud of Crimea. Britain is telling whom? To Austria and Prussia, don't interfere in Italian affairs. They are my friends. Because of Cavour going to Crimean War, he has got Britain at his back. Right? Then French neutrality was purchased by Cavour. You know what Cavour said? Cavour said that if you help me by remaining neutral while I fight with Austrians, I will give you territory of Nice and Savoy. So France was once again promised, I will give you territory. France is under an impression that Cavour is my friend. March 1860, plebiscite held and state of Parma, Modena, Tuscany, Rome and Bologna merged with Piedmont, Sardinia. Austria could do nothing. Britain is supporting. France is neutral. In March 1860, a voting was done. Plebiscite is voting where all North Italian states voted and joined Piedmont, Sardinia. Now, this is unification of North Italy. North Italy is unified. With this unification, Piedmont, Sardinia became more strong now, right? What happens next after this? Integration of Umbria, Marches and Naples, Sicily. This is south of Italy now. How will you bring South Italy together? Political transformations going in north of Italy now emboldened people of Naples, Sicily to rise against the rule of Bourbon dynasty. So south of Italy is now ready to fight against the French occupation and the French rulers. Due to possibility of French reaction, Cavour could not directly interfere in Naples, Sicily. If Cavour, as Prime Minister of Piedmont, Sardinia, will go directly in Naples, Sicily, then the King of France will turn enemy and I want him to be neutral. So Cavour now plays diplomacy. He used Garibaldi. Third character is Garibaldi, Mazzini, Cavour and Garibaldi. Now Cavour as Prime Minister used Garibaldi for liberation of Naples and Sicily. Garibaldi is another Italian nationalist who is a very strong warrior. If I say Mazzini was the soul of Italian unification, I will say Cavour is the brain of Italian unification. And then I will say Garibaldi was the sword for unification. He fought the wars and brought unification. Right? So, what will happen next? Garibaldi, an Italian nationalist and freelance soldier, had a small group of troops with him and they were called Red Shirts. In ideology, he was follower of Mazzini. He wanted strong Italy. He has made his army to fight. It's like Bhagat Singh in India. Bhagat Singh and his Naujawan Bharat Sabha. right? They are ready to fight and like die for the cause of their nation. In May 1860, Sicily conquered by Garibaldi. He went there with his army, defeated the French kings, and now he got the territory of Sicily. And in August 1860, Naples also liberated. Now that Garibaldi has conquered south of Italy, the king of France is very surprised. He was asking Cavour, what is this going on? He said, I don't know, who is he? Who is Garibaldi? Even I am surprised, from where did he come in the picture? I don't know him, and let me see what he's doing and I will help you, don't worry. Right? Garibaldi was dreaming of creation of republican state. He always wanted a republic. So he thought that now that south of Italy is independent of France, let's create a republic, and refused merging the territories with North Italy. Now Cavour has a suspicion against Garibaldi that he is not coming to my side. Now what he will do? Next, Cavour met French King Napoleon III and convinced him about dangers of possible republic. He said to the French King Napoleon III, if Garibaldi will create a republic in south, he will be not in my control, right? He will be independent. And then that independent fratric, if he will attack the papal kingdom in central Italy, I will not be able to help them. So I would like you to now send your army to protect the Pope. So French army is invited in central Italy. By whom? By Cavour. Why he wanted the French army in central Italy? So that Garibaldi must not conquer and become more powerful. Now let me explain this once again, because this is again something which is complex. What has happened is, entire north of Italy is now united with Piedmont Sardinia. Then there is central Italy under Pope, and then there is south Italy, which has now been controlled by Garibaldi. When Garibaldi got south of Italy, he was sent though by Cavour, but now he wants it to be a republic. So Cavour immediately talked to Napoleon III of France that I don't know what he is up to, but if he is able to make it a republic, in that case, he can then attack Pope. So I request you, Mr. Napoleon, please put your French army on the borders of Pope's territory so that Garibaldi must not attack central Italy. Done. Now Garibaldi is trapped in south Italy. Cavour has stopped his movement into central Italy. Otherwise, Garibaldi would have become very strong. What happens next now is, Napoleon allowed Cavour to conquer papal states of Umbria, marches to counter Garibaldi, but Rome was not to be touched. Right? Usne usko thoda sa aage aane diya. Cavour met French King III and convinced him about the dangers of possible republic. And what he allowed Garibaldi doing? Napoleon III allowed Cavour to conquer papal states of Umbria and marches to counter Garibaldi, but Rome was not to be touched. Ab usne bola ki isne na itna sa jeet liya. He has got this much of the territory. Immediately put the French army to protect Pope here. So French soldiers were sent to Pope to protect him. After this, in September 1860, Umbrian march is captured by troops led by King Victor Emmanuel II and Cavour. Now from north, Cavour went to south and took control of Umbrian marches. Then in October 1816, plebiscite was held in south, and Naples and Sicily, as a result, all these territories merged with North Italy. Ab yahan par bhi voting karai gayi South Italy mein. Cavour said to Garibaldi, Mr. Garibaldi, let's try understand something. It is not you who will decide whether it is a republic or not. People of Italy will decide. You are a democrat, na? Let people decide. Let there be vote. And when voting happened, all were impressed by Piedmont Sardinia and Cavour. They all voted, we want to join Piedmont Sardinia. Now north and south of Italy has become one under Cavour as prime minister. Clear ho gaya? North and south became one under prime minister of Cavour. Result of Piedmontese opened eyes of Garibaldi, realized his mistakes and surrendered to King Victor Emmanuel, who pardoned him. Garibaldi said, I am sorry, I was thinking of making independent state. Now that people want to join north, let it be. I have no objection. I'm sorry. Let me go. 7 November 1860, Victor Emmanuel became king of United Italy, north and south. Only central Italy is left now. Now, how to bring central Italy? This is last step. Integration of Venetia in 1866 and integration of Rome. two steps and then Italian unification is finished. Then I will again explain on the board without these slides. Venetia integrated in 1866 when war of Austria and Prussia started. Now look at this and you will laugh with this fact of history. Prussia, that means Germany, is fighting with Austria. It is altogether a different war between Germany, Prussia and Austria. Chancellor Bismarck of Prussia made an agreement with Italian King Victor Emmanuel while fighting for Prussia. Now, what is this? Bismarck is making a plan that I will go and attack Austria. And he signed an agreement with Italy. As per the agreement, Italy to attack Austria from south of Venetia, irrespective of outcome of Italian campaign, Venetia to be given to Italy. What is the agreement? When Prussia will attack Austria, Italy will also attack Austria. And when Italy and Prussia together will attack Austria, Austria will be defeated. And Prussia promised that you will get the territory of Venetia. Austria defeated Italian forces in July 1888, but Prussia defeated Austria in the Battle of Sidova and Venetia merged with Italy. Italy still was not that powerful that it could defeat Austria. Austria defeated Italy, but because Prussia defeated Austria, now Venetia is merged with Italy. You get your remaining territory. Italy is unified. Now only Rome is left. That means central Italy. How smart this man Cavour is. Rome was protected by French troops. Who asked the French troops to come? Cavour, right? Rome was protected by French troops. King Victor Emmanuel II waited for the right opportunity. When the opportunity came in 1870, France declared war on Prussia. Now, when France is to fight against Prussia, troops protecting Pope withdrawn. The moment France withdrew the troops, King Victor Emmanuel II got opportunity, Rome declared as capital of Italy, and Pope given the Vatican to remain as sovereign republic. Italian unification complete 1870, and the credit goes to Mr. Cavour, who planned everything. Now look at this. If I explained you last time, there is one Italy divided into three parts, north, central, and south. In north, Austria controls. In south, France controls. In center, Pope controls. In north, there is Piedmont Sardinia, which is the only native Italian ruling state with the Savoy dynasty. What happened now? Before the coming of Napoleon, this was the situation in Italy. Then Napoleon came, he defeated the Austrians, he defeated the Pope. He's from France, he got control in south. Entire Italy has come under common control of Napoleon. Once they came under common control of Napoleon, nationalism in Italy started to grow. But Napoleon did not let Italy become independent. He kept outside control of France. So the Italians were not happy and they wanted to get freedom from outsiders. Then Napoleon was defeated. Then Congress of Vienna was called. At Congress of Vienna, Austria got the same position restored. In North, Austria got control. In South, France got control. In center, Pope was again restored. But while doing this, Piedmont Sardinia was given additional territory. This strong Piedmont Sardinia in future will bring Italian unification. Now, when 1830 revolution happened, they tried to bring one strong Italy, but they failed because Metternich did not let the revolt be a success. After failure of 1830 efforts, in 1831, Mazzini comes to picture. He makes Young Italy for inspiring the Italians to make United Italy. Then when 1848 revolutions happened, now Piedmont Sardinia, with the support of Central and South Italy, tried to defeat Austria, but they did not support. So Austria won and Piedmont Sardinia could not get the North territory. But lesson is clear. Only Piedmont Sardinia can lead unification. The king goes, Charles Albert. New king Victor Emmanuel comes to power. He made Cavour his prime minister. And now he will plan for national unification. He will first make Piedmont Sardinia a role model. टू क्रिएट फेवरेबल एक्सटर्नल इन्वायरमेंट कैवूर विल सेंड सोल्जर्स टू क्रीमियन वॉर एंड बाय दिस ही विल विन फ्रेंड्स इन ब्रिटेन एंड फ्रांस एंड नाउ दैट ही हैज फ्रेंड्स इन ब्रिटेन एंड फ्रांस विद फ्रांस ही साइंड पोलियम्बर्स पैक्ट थ्रू विच फ्रांस प्रोमिस दैट इफ ऑस्ट्रिया अटैक्स फ्रांस विल सेंड आर्मी टू हेल्प पिडमोंट सार्दिनिया नाउ टू प्रोवोक ऑस्ट्रेलिया टू अटैक ही कैवूर instigated revolts in Lombardy. As Lombardy revolted, Austria sent soldiers. So France had to send soldiers to help Piedmont Sardinia. With the help of French army, Lombardy was taken over by Piedmont Sardinia. Venetia was left. It is still with Austria and they could not get it. But France withdrew because France thought that why to let our soldiers die for Italy. Meanwhile, Cavour wanted to win Venetia, but King did not agree, so he gave his resignation. But then in Parma, Modena, Tuscany, revolution started. Now King said, sorry, Cavour, you can't go, you have to handle the situation. He said, I will now start from south. Meanwhile, Parma, Modena, Tuscany joined and Britain helped once again and nobody interfered in the affairs of Piedmont Sardinia. Now he sent Garibaldi in south and Garibaldi defeated the French kings and got south of Italy under his control. Garibaldi wanted to make a republic here. Cavour never wanted. So he asked the French king Napoleon III to send his army to protect Pope. So now Garibaldi cannot move further. Meanwhile, Cavour came and asked for a plebiscite and even south integrated with north. But in the meanwhile, in 1866, Austria and Prussia fought. When they fought, now Piedmont Sardinia got even Venetia. And then when in 1870, France and Prussia fought, the French soldiers left central Italy. Now South Italy and North Italy is one. Army of Italy came from both sides. Pope was sitting here. They said, Mr. Pope, you have two options. One, surrender your territory to us. We will give you a place called Vatican, where you rule as a king and Rome will become the capital of United Italy. Two, we can kill you and story ends. Nobody can protect you today. Pope said, I am happy with the first one. Take all the territory, give me only Vatican. I am more happy as a king of Vatican. 1870, Italy is one.